This is about positive psychology, harnessing the power of happiness, personal strength, and mindfulness. The idea that people can be that can become happier by bolstering and using their inherent strengths. This is an interesting idea, is that, you know, if you're in psychotherapy, which can be very helpful, but at some point, it may not be. At some point, it may be if you keep going over things in the past and it can't get resolved, then you create pathways that reinforce that, and the system will set up that gets more sensitized, and those pathways become stronger and stronger and stronger, and now you live your life in the past in certain ways. Now, I think psychotherapy is a great thing to have, but maybe the way it's done for different people, maybe that needs to be changed, and the idea of positive psychology is a different focus. The way you think, you train your brain to think a certain way. It's not magic, it's wiring. It's those nerves taking a certain pathway. Many years ago, and this is not a good example, but in the 60s, I knew a psychiatrist who treated people who were in the Holocaust, who were in concentration camps. And I said, well, it was about reparations, you know, and he said he had to evaluate them. And I said, well, when you talk to them, did they have any, you know, catharsis, or was they able to resolve it? And he looked at me, because this is the day where the psychiatrist, you know, spent 45 minutes talking to you. I mean, it was a whole thing, and they did, you know, training in that. He said, he looked at me like I was crazy. He goes, no, I told him to lock it away, put it away. There'll never be enough therapy to grapple with that. It ain't going to happen. You can talk about it, you can get some resolution at some level, but that piece is buried in your amygdala, and if you scratch it, it will pop up. It's like the death of a loved one, death of a child. You move on. So I'm saying is you have to then focus on things that give you joy. If you're focused on the things that have made you suffer, you continue to suffer. It has, you know, it's like life. So this is a concept about positive psychology, that focusing on the positive things may help you grapple with the things that are sad in your life and refocus you. Learned helplessness. We have become a society of learned helplessness. If you take a rodent, and you drop it, a little baby rodent, into water, cold water, ice cold water, it could swim, you know, for maybe 23 hours to stay alive. It wants to stay alive. It's inherent in the system to stay alive. Now take the same rodent and hold it so it stops squirming. Like, you know, when you grab a dog, stop squirming. You hold it so it stops squirming. It's helpless. It's learned to be helpless. And you drop it in the water, it sinks to the bottom and drowns. It's learned helplessness. We have created a society of learned helplessness. I'm not saying not to take your meds. I'm not saying any of those things. I'm just saying that there's a shift. And that we're saying, I don't know. I'm not feeling well. And I went to the doctor and he gave me a pill. And I take my pill. I go, what are we, automatons? It ultimately won't work well. So we don't want to be learned helplessness. I mean, how many stories do you hear of people saying, they told me I couldn't do this, I wouldn't be able to walk, I wouldn't be able to that. Now, sometimes you can't. But if you listen to what everybody told you could or couldn't do, if I did, I wouldn't be up here right now. I wouldn't be a physician. So being that way is not a positive thing. Versus learned helplessness versus learned optimism. I was just listening to this thing this morning. It was very interesting. I think they did it in Massachusetts. The two most important questions to ask that are the highest risk for what's going to happen to you, like in terms of like having a heart attack, is, are you a happy person? Do you love your work? Or really like your work? If you answered no to either one of those things, your risk of dying increased significantly. Everything else being the same. If you didn't like your job, or you weren't happy, person in general, it was one of the greatest risk factors you could have. And of course, when I was listening to this thing, it was saying that the time that people have, the day of the week that have the most heart attacks is Monday. And if there's a time in that day, guess what time it is? It was 9 o'clock in the morning. And what's the connection between how you feel and then you got a heart attack? Why? But unhappiness, you're right. That sets into motion a cascade of events that affects the whole body. It isn't just in your mind. Any more than if you've got a cattle prod in the wrong place, somebody says, you need to calm down, you need to relax. You go, yeah, take the cattle prod out and I'll feel a lot better. So you need both of these things are part of the equation. It's not one or the other. All right, so going back a little bit to positive psychology, let's see how it translates into actual practical things. The University of Wisconsin measured brain electrical activity before a two-month course in mindfulness meditation. And they found persistent increased activity of the left side of the prefrontal cortex associated with joyful and serene emotions. All right, this is how it kind of works out. When you do meditation, you force the brain to be, let's say, as an example, in the present moment. You know, you don't tell them, you don't say, don't think of this thought, don't think that thought, but by focusing on the present moment, it's a natural pushback. It's very hard to do. But by doing that in the present moment, it shifts to being relaxed and comfortable and joy, and that's more the left side, the creative side, the relaxed side of the brain. So the pathways shift in that direction. The neurons are now activated going there. And the more you do it, the more those neurons grow, the more the synapses become, you know, entangled in other in other areas. And then, remember we talked about in other discussions about the neurons are like trees of sorts, and they communicate information. And you've got the bark of the tree, and you've got the branches of the tree, and those branches grow, and the bark becomes stronger, and things move faster. And that's what makes it work easily. And so they shifted. So you can shift from the right side of your brain, which is more concerned about anxiety, stress, things that might hurt you. They're important. You have to have that. And it shifts it from the right side of your brain to the left side when you're in the moment. Because when you're in the moment, you can't be anxious. It's like you can't have both. It's very hard to do. I mean, it's easy in theory, but people practice this for many years. But if you can do it, and you can, most of us can, it actually readjusts how your nerve pathways are going. And that's where you want them. That's what they did. And that's part of this concept called neuroplasticity of the brain. There's a very good book called The Brain That Changes Itself by Dr. Deutsch. The Brain That Changes Itself, excellent. And it talks about the neuroplasticity of the brain. Very impressive.